Over the past 30 years, there's been a huge reduction in malaria cases and deaths in India. It's one of the most spectacular decreases seen in any region. But there are pockets of transmissions that remain, and these are focused mainly in Odisha. And this is the hidden malaria that we're trying to address and to measure.
And this particular research study is extremely critical because all of us know that we are moving ahead with a malaria elimination goal. And Odisha still continues to be one of the largest contributor to malaria incidence and burden. So as long as we don't eliminate malaria from Odisha, we cannot eliminate malaria from India.
ICEMR stands for International Centres of Excellence for Malaria Research. It is a program that is funded by the National Institutes of Health in the US. So the India ICEMR is one of these sub-centres, and ours has been running since 2010. Hidden malaria, it's or asymptomatic or sub-patent, there are different kind of variations of the same concept, is something that's quite interesting. When you are exposed repeatedly to the malaria parasite, your body kind of adjusts to it. So instead of becoming sick, it kind of decreases the number of parasites that you have in your body and allows you to avoid developing a fever, for example. So that's good for you. However, what happens in the long term is because you're not sick, you don't seek treatments, and therefore you perpetuate the transmission of the malaria parasite. We have a great team based here in Odisha, led by Dr. Sanjay Mohanty in Rourkela and Dr. Sangamitra Patti in Bhubaneswar. At the moment, we're trying to start our baseline survey. RMRC Bhubaneswar is the regional medical research center, which belongs to the Indian Council of Medical Research, and will oversee all our research in one of the districts.
If you look at the distribution of malaria in the state, you will see that it is primarily concentrated in tribal population, in hard to reach areas, in geographically difficult terrain. And this, our project is also very strategically positioned in those pockets, in those areas where still we find a reservoir of malaria continuing.
We are going to visit 3,000 individuals every 6 months for 4 years. And the idea is really to see how they evolve in terms of malaria infection over the 4 years. We're going to take some blood samples to also measure antibodies to look at their response to the malaria parasite. And this can inform us in terms of their recent or their past infections in terms of malaria. The problem is when the number of parasites goes below a certain threshold, the tests that we use fail to detect them, meaning that even if you're infected, you go to the hospital, you get a test, the test may become negative even if you're still infected. You're not treated, and then you go back into the community where you continue transmitting the disease through the mosquitoes. The Community Welfare Society Hospital is a site that we've been working with for a long time now. They're extremely well equipped. They have everything they need to get started and analyze the samples.
So these samples are collected from the field surveys where the participants normally offer a finger prick and they donate about 200 to 300 microliter of blood. And the first thing that is being performed here is the kind of identification of the parasite, if at all it is present inside the blood. So for that, the compound microscopy is performed by trained microscopists in our lab. For field samples, which are coming from participants which are having no symptoms of the disease, they might not be presenting the adequate parasitemia to be diagnosed with microscopy. In such case scenario, you do not have a choice but to move on to the higher level of diagnostic methods like PCR. A PCR detects perfectly a particular segment of the parasite DNA, which is actually spreading the infection. If there is a match, then you will find a molecular detection as positive. We can then designate that sample as malaria positive, which is otherwise negative in the routine diagnostic kits.
We are also going to try and detect and identify and validate some new biomarkers that could be used to develop new diagnostic tests. So microRNA is one of these fields where nobody's looking into it, and then suddenly everybody's looking into it. This is a field that is still in its infancy and is extremely promising. And so now we're trying to see whether we can harness these and use them to detect hidden malaria. And one of the key people is Dr. Himanshu Gupta, who's leading that part of the analysis at GLA University.
MicroRNAs are small, tiny molecules which are available in our body, and their role is to do gene activity or regulate the gene activity. And why they are promising is because that these microRNAs are highly sensitive. So at the time of any pathogen entry in the body, or organ damage, or any inflammation, will lead to change in microRNA levels. So my work aligns with biomarker discovery as well as little bit of diagnostics. Biomarkers are those molecules which are being associated with certain condition. Like for example, in case of pregnancy, we test HCG level. So HCG, presence of that HCG level in the urine is an indicator of a pregnancy. So that is the biomarker. The ultimate goal for my research is to come up with the biomarkers which are specific for severe malaria, asymptomatic malaria, or parasite which are hidden in the organs. And if we are if we have these kind of biomarkers, so we can develop a point of care test. So if we are able to find asymptomatic people and if we can treat them, so this will allow us to break the transmission of the malaria infection, and ultimately it will help us to control the malaria.
Our team really has a combination of unique expertise, and whether it is in terms of field work and this really strong experience in conducting surveys at the village level that we have, but also emerging new fields like microRNAs, for example. And the idea is really to put together these complementary approaches to try to understand better what drives the persistence of malaria in Odisha and what enables the persistence of this hidden malaria there.
Now that we are going ahead with the last mile of elimination, we require research more than ever. So what is more important is that we are looking at how it can be adopted and scaled up, creating a global solution for malaria-free future, because, I mean, the world cannot be free from malaria unless every country is not free.